I'm going to provide you with a brief overview of the participants and context sections of a method in a thesis or a paper. Now, when we're talking about participants, we start off with a descriptive phrase about how the participants were selected, and that can be part of a longer sentence. So we want to know whether they're volunteers, whether they were randomly selected, or whether it was a sample of convenience, for example, your class. Now, we really want to include the first five of these: the total number of participants, the gender breakdown, the age or age range, the experience level, and education level. So those are pretty important characteristics to include. And then we can add any relevant characteristics that could be perceived as having an influence on how the data will be interpreted, for example, socioeconomic status or computer ability. Now, if you have two or more populations, for example, you collected data from both students and teachers, you'd want to describe each in two separate subsections. Now, with respect to context, you want to describe where your data was collected. In general, you're including all the relevant characteristics that gives the reader a sense of the setting. So you can include ESL population, for example, if it was in a school setting, average income, whether the population was rural, suburban, or urban, and actually a number describing the size of the population, for example, 400,000 or 2 million. Those characteristics can make a difference. In a sense, you're giving the reader a description of how generalizable your setting, your research is. So what I mean by that is when you see the results here and you have 1,000 participants and they're from a very urban, a big urban area, very multicultural, you might be able to generalize the results more than if it was a small sample in an isolated rural community. So let's go to some concrete examples. So here the student has participants and there's a teacher and students, okay? And so a description of the teacher is provided about her years of experience and her comfort level with mathematics and her experience with blogging. So that's important to this study, and the kind of tools that she had available to her, a laptop, a projector, smart board. So it gives you an idea of the teacher. You could probably include age here. I think that would be also important. And education level. You don't always collect all that data, so think about it ahead of time so that you aren't caught without the data, as the student was. Now let's take a close look at the student population. Here there are 48 grade 9 students, so we know the level of education they have, and we know the number of males and females. Five didn't respond. They're 13 to 16 years old, selected from two classes in a large urban secondary school. And then it goes on to describe the school and the population of grade 9 students. And then there's a description of English as a second language. There's almost one-fifth of the students have English as a second language or were identified with special needs. And the average income is 80,000. And then there were 27 students from an academic stream and 21 students from an applied stream. All right, so there's a good discussion here. This is somewhat contextual, but it describes the school, so it fits nicely in this section. Then it goes on here to talk about their comfort level with using technology, which the student thought was important. Now here we have the context of teaching, and that is important. What are the teaching strategies that the instructor used? And that gives someone a sense of how typical this classroom is or what was going on when this specific method was applied. They were using mathematics and blogging. In short, the more detail you can provide about that context, relevant detail, the better, so that the reader can really understand the setting in which the study occurred. Now here's a second example. Now, the student used sample description. It's typical to use participants now. Samples are more in scientific papers, so we generally see the word participants in education papers. That can vary. So this student wrote, volunteers were recruited. Okay, so this is volunteers for three sections. This is the total N here of a computer programming course. So we start to get the context and the year. We don't often put the year in, but you could. And then it talks a bit about the college and the size of the college and the number of courses, number of students in each section. And then we have this student went into a lot of detail about the response rates. Sometimes you put the response rate if you're doing volunteers, using volunteers. So you might say, I asked 150. So keep that in mind. And 50 responded. So that's a 33% response rate. So you if you are selecting volunteers and you know the size of the sample that you're asking for, then you can use that simple equation, the number of students that responded from the total number asked, and you can get a response rate. That's important too. Here's an age description here, and specific ages and the ranges here. So the student's really gone into a lot of detail. Then he describes the computing skills and whether they have the prerequisite. And clearly, this is a range of questions asked and what students can do. And so obviously here, the 100%, 98%, a lot of the students can do most of these tasks. Then the student goes on to describe the culture of learning. So that's context. I like culture of learning. And describe specific characteristics about that culture and their specific attitudes towards teaching strategies. And that's a very long section. You don't normally get that. But again, the student felt that they needed to describe these details so that someone looking at the data, including the student himself, could look at it within a certain framework and understand the context. So those are two examples when you're looking at the participants and context section in a method.